All right, guys, so you may have noticed that we haven't put up any content during Intel's Coffee Lake launch day, and that's because I was working on something very interesting for you guys. So I won't be talking about the technical specifications or the technical details about Intel's newest architecture, since I've already covered that in this video. Instead, I really want to cover what people can expect when they decide to upgrade to Intel's newest processor, the i7-8700K. This isn't going to be the usual Intel versus AMD thing, but rather a comparison of an older system to a newer one, provided you want to stay within Intel's platform. So without any further ado, let's get into it. But first, a quick message from our sponsor.
The new NZXT Air RGB fans can be daisy-chained together for awesome lighting cohesion in your build with vibrant and accurate color illumination, all easily controlled through the Hue Plus via CAM software. Full details in the description below.
Alright, so let's talk about the older system, because our editor Mike, aka SkyMTL, has been teasing it for about a week on Twitter. This is Intel's Z68 platform that was launched all the way back in January 2011, but don't let its age of more than 6 years fool you. Many people jumped onto Sandy Bridge platform and they have skipped Ivy Bridge, Haswell, Skylake, and Kaby Lake entirely because there really wasn't any reason to. One of the main reasons behind Sandy Bridge's lasting popularity is this processor, the i7-2600K, which was launched for about $320 and was actually well-priced compared to some previous generation Linfield processors. This is why Coffee Lake launch is such a big deal right now. After 6 years, the evolved 14nm++ manufacturing process on these new processors has allowed Intel to finally move their i7 series away from that quad-core layout that's been with us since Sandy Bridge was launched. The i7-8700K uses 6 cores along with 12 threads, and it costs $360. While that's a good $40 more than the i7-2600K launched at, the premium reflects the price of inflation between 2011 and 2017, almost perfectly, so in today's dollars, this Coffee Lake CPU doesn't technically cost more. Now, with its high speeds and more cores, Intel also claims that there are notable performance improvements over older processors, but that's also a matter of platform improvements too. Z68 or other chipsets of the Sandy Bridge generation are actually considered very capable by today's standards, but there are some key technologies which they are missing. Back in 2011, features like USB 3.1 Gen 2, Thunderbolt, M.2, NVMe were not around, and even the current SATA 6 gigabits per second interface was added to Z68 through slow third-party controllers. The same goes for PCIe 3.0, which wasn't natively supported by Sandy Bridge, but was tacked onto a few motherboards later on. Even though motherboards like this ASUS Z370E Strix Gaming may not be all that much different from Z270, it does have more connectivity options than Z68. So you can consider that as a benefit to looking at these newer components. But what I'm after here isn't to compare Z370 and Z68. What I want to find out is whether or not people with Sandy Bridge processors should finally look into upgrading. Basically, the test setups will consist of the Z370 Strix and i7-8700K, or the ASUS PZ68V Pro and the i7-2600K. Along with those, I'll be using a GTX 1070, 16GB of memory, all the other components you see in this chart. There's also a completely fresh install of Windows 10 and multi-core enhancement was turned off. The only major difference will be the memory speeds, with Sandy Bridge operating at 1333MHz, while the Coffee Lake system will be operating at 2666MHz. Those speeds were chosen since they represent the upper range of Intel's stock specifications. Don't worry though, I'll get into overclocking later on. Okay, so now on to benchmarks, and I'm actually going to skip the synthetic tests and move on to real-world testing and gaming. Something else I should mention is that there should be no doubt that the 8700K is going to win, and the question is whether or not it wins by enough to make upgrading worth the while. Let's start things off with Adobe Premiere Pro, since it happens to be a program I use all the time. Honestly, a video editor would have likely upgraded away from Sandy Bridge a long, long time ago, and this is why. Just remember, the 2600K operates at a maximum speed of 900MHz lower than the 8700K and has 4 less processing threads. So of course, Coffee Lake will win. In rendering tasks, the 8700K walks all over the 2600K, and in a big way too. It takes less than half the amount of time to render the same scene at stock settings. Like many other programs, since GIMP is natively a single-threaded program, Coffee Lake's additional threads and other optimizations can't be put to full use. That means it still beats Sandy Bridge by a noticeable margin, but nothing like we've seen in previous multi-core tests. If you're someone that edits photos for a living, I'd still recommend you look into an upgrade, since this amount of time being saved could lead to money being saved on your end. Switching back to a program that benefits from both multi-core enhancements and overall frequencies, tells us that the i7-8700K jumps way out of a massive lead again. But honestly guys, remember that Coffee Lake is being compared against a processor that was launched 6 years ago, so the improvements were expected, we just wanted to properly put them into context. By now it should be pretty obvious that Coffee Lake will keep winning rendering tests by a big margin, and that's what POV ray shows. I was actually expecting WinRAR results to be a bit closer since its algorithms typically benefit from faster platform storage, lower memory latency, and high clock speeds. However, after I looked a bit closer at the output, it looks like the i7-2600K was actually preventing the SSD from writing information at its peak speeds. The processor became a bottleneck. Okay guys, so you probably didn't need any of those last charts to tell you that Coffee Lake could beat Sandy Bridge without a problem. But for people who are rocking the 2600K and who care about saving time with processor intensive tasks, could benefit from making the step up to Coffee Lake. But what about gaming? You see, with modern processors, we've shown that more cores don't necessarily lead to higher frame rates. In fact, in most cases, the GPU becomes the bottleneck long before the CPU does. So what happens when we throw a 6-year-old processor into the mix? Now to run these tests, I'm going to be using this Gigabyte GTX 1070, which should give us a good balance of performance for the price you pay. Just to make things a bit more interesting, I'm also going to throw in a comparison with one of the fastest graphics cards available when the 2600K was around, the NVIDIA GTX 680. Just remember that the GTX 680 is technically compatible with DX12, but many of the API's primary rendering optimizations just won't work with the GPU's hardware. That and its smaller 2GB frame buffer caused performance to suffer in a big way. And I know a lot of you guys came here for this, and let me tell you, the results are pretty eye-opening. At slightly lower resolution of 1080p, the results are really interesting, with the 2600K being only a few frames per second behind the new i7-8700K. Remember, 1080p is supposed to put more stress on the CPU, but it looks like the 2600K is completely able to hold its own for the most part. But there is a difference when we look at the bottom 1% frame rates. In DX11 titles like Call of Duty, Grand Theft Auto, and Overwatch, it looks like the 8700K delivers a much smoother gaming experience. DX12 shows both cards pretty much even though. There really isn't much to say about this 6-year-old setup of a 2600K and a GTX 680, since just adding a GTX 1070 could double or even triple your frame rates. Okay, let's move on to a bit more demanding resolution of 1440p. Now, since even more of the processing needs are directed towards the graphics card, both the 2600K and 8700K end up running neck to neck. Even those lower 1% frame rates get closer, but there are still a very few DX11 games where the 8700K provides a slight improvement in overall smoothness. But that smoothness is subjective, since it's doubtful that many will see the on-screen difference between these two processors. Meanwhile, the GTX 680 drops even further behind, since its 2GB frame buffer just gets overwhelmed at this resolution. But not so fast here. What about overclocking? Remember, these are two unlocked Intel processors, and actually, the i7-2600K was one of the best clocking processors we've ever had here at HyperConnex. So let's see what kind of additional performance we can squeeze out of these things. Let's start with how far they overclock with proper stability. The i7-8700K hits 5.145 GHz with a memory speed of 3600 MHz, while the 2600K ended up getting all the way to just over 4.8 GHz with the memory running at just 2300 MHz. The results are pretty good for both processors. In both Adobe Premiere and Handbrake, the jump in clock speeds results in much better performance for the i7-2600K, but it still doesn't come anywhere closer to beating a stock 8700K. The 8700K doesn't really extend its lead by all that much in Handbrake, but that extra clock speed works wonders in Premiere. Switching to gaming, and the results are pretty much the same as before, since the graphics card ends up being a bottleneck in all of the cases. But what you can see here is that the overclock did improve the 2600K's 99 percentile frame rates in Overwatch, bringing its overall performance closer to the 8700K. That's pretty impressive, guys, and we only needed to upgrade the graphics card. Just to be completely thorough, I also decided to test power consumption, and those results weren't really a surprise either. From a performance per watt standpoint, the Coffee Lake processor is miles ahead of the 2600K, but the 8700K does consume quite a bit of power when it's overclocked. Just remember that because I don't feel the 8700K delivers additional performance to justify that 50 watt increase. Well, there you have it, guys, and I'm gonna wrap this up quickly since the results do speak for themselves. Now, if you're someone who's in much need of faster encryption, of faster rendering for day-to-day professional tasks, the 8700K is an awesome upgrade, provided you can find one in stock. And yes, you will need a new motherboard and memory, But those are good investments for the time you'll save. What really shocked all of us here at Hurricane X was just how closely matched the 2600K and 8700K were in games, especially in DX12 and Vulkan applications. Meanwhile, DX11 seemed to very slightly favor the higher clock speeds of Coffee Lake. But is that minor difference worth the price of a new system? Absolutely not. If the primary use of your system is gaming, you are much better off maximizing your graphics card upgrade, even if your motherboard still has a PCIe 2.0 interface. While the newer Z370 platform does bring connectivity benefits and potentially more processing cores, at least with games I tested, recommending it to a pure gaming upgrade is extremely hard. So what do you guys think about this comparison? Were you surprised by the results? And are you planning on upgrading? Let me know in the comments down below. I'm Eber with Hurricane X. Thank you so much for watching. Make sure to subscribe for more similar content, and we'll see you in the next one.